Good morning and welcome to Cheche, the show where opinion counts, live on Citizen TV. I'm your host, Udwak Amimo. Now, some form of corruption has made it to the headlines since the year began, whether it's funds missing, phantom projects, or electoral fraud. Kenya seems to be grappling with an unprecedented scale of corruption. The opposition say the fault lies with the government. The leader of the NARC Kenya Party and presidential aspirant Martha Karua is in the opposition and holds that view. She's our guest this morning. As always, we have the panel of Mutegi Njau and David Makali. And so we welcome you all and say good morning to you, Ms. Karua.
Mm-hmm.
Now, corruption has been present in every government since independence. What's exceptional about what we're seeing at the moment?
I think the levels of corruption today are unprecedented. They dwarf the previous scandals, and the frequency of the scandals being unearthed is a bit too much. It's gotten to ridiculous levels, from pens that cost 7,000 to managers being removed from government accounts and taken away by individuals. Look at what is happening, has been happening at the youth fund, where money is just withdrawn. Or that Kabura affidavit, where millions, tens of millions are withdrawn from the bank and carted away by individuals. And one is wondering, we've heard of a few ministries, what is happening in the others? Because this seems to be the norm.
Previous governments had defining scandals, but the argument could also be made that this government, the reason why we're hearing, you know, you've mentioned several, some around the devolution ministry, we've heard various others, but the argument could be made that because of the attention to, you know, scrutiny and openness, we know more about what's going wrong than we did in the past. That Anglo Gold and Anglo Leasing and Goldenberg were the tip of the iceberg. There were other things going on that we did not know about.
I think if there's something going on eventually, it ought to come through the Controller and Auditor General's report. And that's how government and the public gets to know of what is happening in ministries. But look, in this government, the office of the Controller and Auditor General is under attack. They want the right to loot without being held to account. They don't want anybody snooping around and reporting on what they are doing. So I am saying that this is the worst that has ever gotten. And then we are not seeing prosecution. We started with the disabling of the Anti-Corruption Commission, you know, forcing commissioners to resign. And the one that was left holding out was also literally forced out. And then you leave the staff and you call them a commission. It cannot be a commission without the commissioners. Now that it has been reconstituted, until they actually vet the secretariat, the commission cannot get the respect and the trust of Kenyans. I believe they really must move very fast, vet the secretariat, which was something of a joke in their purported fight against
Trump. I'll bring the panelists in because Ms. Karua mentions the Auditor General, and the 2013-2014 report said something about just over 1% of allocated funds could be accounted for. Couldn't account, you know, properly for about over 90%. And the CS for Treasury wrote back to say there was no mismanagement. Are we blowing things out of proportion, or is there a serious problem here?
I've reported about corruption since I was a reporter in the 80s. But what I'm seeing now is I cannot understand. In fact, I wanted to ask Mother Karua, what is the reason why? Because when you read the Auditor General's, you remember at one time, President Moi dissolved the Public Accounts Committee and set a different one for parastatals, because he wanted to, they wanted to consume money through parastatals, which was not independent like Auditor General. But what you are seeing now is there is no day that I'm reading newspapers or review newspapers and I don't see a story about corruption. Today, there's a story about the National Oil Corporation. which we did not know yesterday. Every angle, every, it looks like every ministry, every prestato, every police, everybody who is there wants to steal. And the, what she is saying that the Auditor General, first of all, they have denied them the money, the staff, and of course they want to shield themselves from audit. These are supposed to be young people who came in style, you know, the president and the president in white shirts, right, operating up. And they were very impressive. But what are we seeing?
Okay. David, what do you think? Mutegi says that in 30 years of covering Kenya, he's never seen corruption so bad.
It could not be any different. I mean, with every government, we have increased the enormity of our everything. With its budget, whether it is scandal, everything seems to be
multiplied. And so therefore the opportunities to steal.
The opportunities keep rising. I think corruption has been the hallmark of every government. From the Moi one, and I was so impressed the other day, Moi saying, no, it's too much. Stop it, guys. that really had a lot of people laughing. But that just shows that really, even the most conservative and forgiving of Kenyans has found something to be wrong with this administration. But the phenomenon of how much corruption is exposed depends on the makeup of that government. I think Martha Karua was in the Grand Coalition one. Corruption seems to be more explicit in a government that is a patch-up of two coalitions, such as the Grand Coalition. There is always mechanisms inside there that generate exposure, exposes. So under Grand Coalition, there were scandals which came by virtue of the people on the PNU side and the ones on the Orange side trying to outdo each other or feel jealous of what the other side was doing. The same with this administration, the Jubilee administration. You can see there is a discordance between the TNA and affiliates and the URP affiliates. And take it or leave it, there is a lot of unease between these two partners in government. And so we're going to see more of this corruption being exposed because there is jealousy, envy of how the other one might
because
be
doing.
Because
they're outing
work.
Each other, they're
yes,
telling
they're
on each other.
Each other. But the scale of corruption obviously has more than trebled. It's really big. This is, people are going into government and everybody is preoccupied with fixing deals. That's it, that's what's happening.
I don't think it's a question of party. Because whether it's TNA,
yeah,
whether it's TNA, whether the URP, they are there. To me, it looks like the projects they are doing these days. They are doing not projects not to succeed, but to steal. They are cooking projects so that they can get something. The whole purpose is to get something out of the project.
Ms. Karua, what I really think, there's a point in what David is saying about tension in a coalition government. I actually saw that the second term of Kibaki, the Grand Coalition, corruption became official, if you like. And that was one of my disagreements that made me, a couple of things that made me eventually leave. And it was like a silent agreement. But even then, the impunity had not risen to the levels that we see, where people cook projects like Mutegi has said, not for the project to succeed, but a conduit to remove the money. And it's actually being cashed. It's like a cash, it's like cashing checks at the counter. And there's no prosecution, no nothing. And the few that are being, I would want to agree with the Kabura analysis of funny charges. We are not seeing anything progressing.
And this is in reference to the affidavit that implicates Madam Waiguru.
But yeah, I'm referring to it generally about government, not about just the NYS.
Okay.
That even when you get people, the charges you bring are funny charges.
Funny charges.
Because you don't intend them to succeed.
Right.
And this is what has happened in successive governments. And the judiciary is also cannot escape some blame.
We'll come to that because the length of the Chief Justice himself has come out to say that there is a corruption within the judiciary.
Yeah.
But you talk about corruption within the Grand Coalition. You were a member of the Grand Coalition government.
Yeah. Yeah.
You weren't as outspoken then as you are now.
I was. If you do remember, as a minister, I was. And I even fought with fellow ministers over issues to do with corruption. I was outspoken inside cabinet and outside cabinet and in parliament, where I was deputy leader of government business at that time. And any time I rose to talk about corruption, there are colleagues who thought it's their name I had called out. And there would be a tussle every time. So actually, I was like an outsider within a setting. And remember, my ministry then, Ministry of Justice, had the mandate in the fight against corruption. That is policy, because the ministry had no mandate to investigate or prosecute. That belonged to the Attorney General. And that was a disconnect. So mine was just to speak about the policy, human rights, and administration of justice. And eventually, I felt that the things that were happening had stripped me off the entire mandate, and therefore had no business remaining in office.
I think that John Githongo and various others, and you know, in civil society who were calling out corruption, have a very different memory of your role within the Grand Coalition government, which was that you weren't quite as outspoken as you were. You defended the government, and when they needed protection from you, it wasn't forthcoming.
Let me assure you, one, Githongo left when I was Minister of Water, because it's that December 2005 that, remember, cabinet was dissolved and then reappointed. So I was appointed now to justice, and he announces in January that he's not coming back, he's in London. So to begin with, I wasn't his minister, okay? So about protection, he couldn't have gotten it from me. I was Minister for Water. And I remember having a conversation with him when I met him in a public place just before he left. I didn't know he was leaving. And I was trying to encourage him and to discuss with him what he could do better, because I was also feeling that the fight against corruption was not going as well. Then fast forward, I come into the ministry. My mandate is policy on fight against corruption. I have no role in investigation save chairing a sub-cabinet committee coordinating the fight against corruption, where the AG is sitting, where the police are coming as the prosecutors, and where the anti-corruption commission, then Ringera, is coming. And all you do is to find out how far they are going, especially in the Anglo-Leasing cases. And because internally you get unhappy with the pace and the way they are doing, I remember one time Ringera saying that he will not be directed by anyone. And you're not directing. All you're doing is suggesting this could be moved a little faster. After all, that is what the committee was all about. So you're a minister. You're the one given that mandate. But you're powerless to have the investigations move, the prosecutions. I remember one time the Attorney General, the police saying this file is ready, and the Attorney General saying I haven't asked you for that file. You see, because if they don't want to prosecute someone, they will not prosecute and they will not give you reasons. They will just say go and investigate. So I do not see how anybody, truthfully speaking, would say that I didn't do my bit, because I couldn't prosecute, I couldn't do whatever. I could only discuss with the president, can you, because he has the power to order any minister, can you ask them to accelerate? I can't order a fellow minister.
And did you find willingness?
Initially, I thought there was willingness. And when I thought there was no willingness, that's when I said I have no support in the work that I'm doing. And I left.
Right.
Yes.
But you know, if you compare Anglo-Leasing and what's happening here now, Anglo-Leasing was a scheme by people in the office of the president, I think, Treasury, the month there being in the office of the president, and those Indians who are making, they try to deny. The difference between that time and now is that those schemes were well organized. This one is just looting, outright looting.
I would not say they are well organized. I would say there was a scheme to supply certain things,
which were not,
and
supplied.
Then the price was exaggerated beyond measure so that they could reap from it.
So eventually, to some extent, there would have been a delivery, but
in some places they delivered, but not really anything to write home about. Like the naval ship was delivered, But it was exaggerated beyond measure.
It was 1.8 billion.
You see, so I remember fighting within government when they decided they were taking possession of the ship. Because for me, it was adopting the theft and owning the theft that had occurred during the Moi regime.
Yeah.
Because Angra leasing started during the Moi regime. It was about the Ministry of Information. It was about Treasury, because the VSAT equipment, communication equipment were whatever. And then security equipment.
The laboratory for the police.
And since it was not completed during the Moi era, people who came in the NARC administration were co-opted.
Yeah.
And they adopted it as a means of get rich. Yeah.
But we seem to be going round and round. I mean, you seem to have hit the wall at your time.
Yeah.
Nothing moved.
Yeah.
The constitution, you mentioned the anti-corruption commission, now it is an anti-corruption. We seem to be going round and round. What really should be the antidote to this, corruption?
Let me say this. The buck stops with the president. And when you campaign for a certain post, if it's for a governor, in the county, the buck stops with you. If it's a national government, the buck stops with the president. And people must understand the job they are seeking, because it is government agencies that we use to enforce the law. The law enforcement agencies are government agencies. Nobody else has the ability to coordinate the work of government other than the president. If it's a cabinet secretary, you are the appointing authority. The Anti-Corruption Commission will have independence. The courts have independence. But you are the coordinator who can sit with these heads and say, guys, how can we accelerate this? That doesn't mean you're interfering with their work. Because government must consult to coordinate the work. But if under your watch you dismantle the agencies that are fighting corruption, if we have delayed...
But is that the president?
It's parliament, but it's under your watch. I say it under your watch.
Yeah, yeah.
If the police reforms are stalled and they do not happen in substance, they are cosmetic, then how do you expect there to be enforcement when the guys themselves are interested in looting? No wonder you hear, when looted money is discovered, the officers who get there, some of them will be later become suspects of devouring that money. Then there is the judiciary. And the judiciary has tried, but not as much as they could have. I have beef with the way the Judicial Service Commission has failed to actualize their supervisory role. Because when you're given disciplinary powers, disciplinary is not just waiting to remove a judge when it gets to the point of removal. It's being able to audit and to give a notice to show cause when a judicial officer's actions are so outrageous that they suggest incompetence, corruption, or both.
Mm. You see, let's come back to leadership, because President Kenyatta said that corruption is a national security threat to the country. Isn't that enough to demonstrate how serious he is about eradicating corruption?
Statement-wise, that's very serious, but not matched by actions. He must pronounce and then act, you see? How long did he take to get the commissioners, did the executive take to get the commissioners of the Anti-Corruption Commission appointed? It's like they wanted to go on with a secretariat without commissioners. A secretariat without commissioners is at the beck and call of the executive. You need commissioners who have some form of security and independence to be able to drive the institution. The secretariat was there courtesy of the executive and parliament, because those
were... Do you think the president is held hostage by some cartels?
I wouldn't give it much credence.
That's what I'm saying. The Gaido article, that the president is held hostage by some fellows who owns about much 400 something.
Okay, let's be clear for the benefit of our viewers who might have missed the articles. There was an article by Ngunjiri Wambogo in The Star, and he's an advisor. You know, we're not quite sure, the exact...
He's
an advisor. Well, I'm not quite sure.
He's somewhere. He plays some role.
yes,
in the Jubilee government.
Right. He's a, and the point that spokesman. He was making in his article was that there are cartels that exist, very powerful, very well-resourced cartels who thwart any sort of real initiatives to deal with corruption. And so the rebuttal came from Asharia Gaitho, writing in The Nation, bemoaning the fact that if this is true, right, then we have a president who isn't capable of dealing with corruption, for the benefit of our viewers.
And the article is alluding that the people, this cartel, maybe have some connection with the president. I think some of them, they may have been schoolmates, or some of them are friends of late Saitoti.
To be fair, I would want to say that the various governments, the last three governments, because those are the ones that I have known about. I might have been too young for the previous one. Have always been comfortable bedfellows with certain cartels. Because when I exited the Kibaki government, I realized that the cartels were being shared on the two sides of the coalition. And there wasn't willingness to deal with the issue. Now this, and the cartels are very clever because election time they capture both sides,
yeah.
The sides that look like they're about to win. So it's like a game, whoever comes in, you're mine. But then if the executive or the president has not resolved to fight those cartels, and he has stood up and told Kenyans, I will fight corruption, then such a president will not be delivering on his mandate, you see? And if one finds that the job you were given is too much for you, the honest thing is to tell Kenyans, sorry, I don't think I can handle this anymore.
I hold the view that we waste too much power or responsibility in commissions,
yeah.
Or in this particular time.
Yeah.
Where we have given the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission, among other commissions, the Gender, there is the Human Rights Commission.
There are 15.
There are so many of them. Actually, some of them whose responsibilities overlap.
Yeah.
But the productivity or results in the areas which they were given mandate is really, doubtful.
Yeah.
And for me, I don't know whether there is much that we shall ever win by having an anti-corruption commission.
Yeah.
An assumption that there will always be corruption and that the other institutions cannot tame that corruption, and only this particular institution will track corruption. And in fact, they don't even have the capacity. They have to depend on the police, which is outside their realm. In prosecution, they still have to go out to some other independent organization or office which may prosecute or not. Isn't this a lame game we go around playing, we have just legalized? So that, it is futile, it's hopeless.
I don't think so, because if you look at other jurisdictions, crime is fought by multi-agencies, but they cooperate. Let's look at the UK, they have the Serious Fraud Office. That's like an anti-corruption commission. And then they have the prosecutors, they have other, everybody has other agencies. You have investigators who don't prosecute. And I'm from the school of thought that would not give the Anti-Corruption Commission prosecutorial powers. And I used to be vocal on that when I was minister. Because I had seen the way the Anti-Corruption Commission was going on about it. And you realize that even a commission that looks like it's serious, individuals can have likes and dislikes. So they'll be reluctant to prosecute Motegi, but they'll be okay prosecuting Martha. So to just ensure that you don't over-concentrate power in the same hands, you give prosecutorial powers to another agency. And all these agencies, because the government is like a jigsaw puzzle. Each piece is separate, but they belong to the whole. We have to learn to share the space. We have to learn to work together.
Yeah.
And in Kenya, we are perfecting the art of everybody working, dancing their own dance, and making it therefore impossible for government to work. The day we will have a president who can properly coordinate and get everybody working together, then we will have unraveled it.
David, I'll allow you to follow up on that after the break. This is Cheche. We're live on Citizen TV. Our SMS number is 22422. You can tweet us using the hashtag Cheche. We're discussing leadership and corruption. What role do you think the opposition can play in helping curb corruption?